Please note this event is being recorded, so please make sure also that your devices are turned off so we don't have any interruptions. Welcome also to our virtual audience. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm joined today by three people who Harvard is really lucky to be hosting here this year. So I'll go down the line to my left, and that's how we'll answer questions as well. So right next to me is Ilya Timtchenko, who is a master and public policy candidate at the Belfer and a Belfer Young Leader Student Fellow at Harvard Kennedy School. And he's also the founder of the Ukraine Caucus there, which is a very active Ukraine organization at Kennedy School. Next to him is Tanya Kozyreva, who is the Murrey, Marder, Nieman Fellow in Watchdog Journalism from the Nieman Foundation for Journalism, also here at Harvard. And last but not least is Prokopyshyn, who is a fellow with the Nieman Foundation for Journalism at Harvard as well. So please join me in welcoming our illustrious fellows. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. So we are going to organize this kind of as a discussion. I have questions that I'm going to ask for all of our panelists. And once we're done going through those questions, we'll open it up to questions from this audience. And if you're watching this on Zoom, please feel free to submit the questions on the Q&A. So I want to start by going back a little bit in history, because as we know, the media landscape in Ukraine has changed really dramatically, not just since the past 10 years in particular, but even since independence. So let's talk a little bit about the media landscape in Ukraine. And in particular, I know all of you have been quite active since 2013 and 2014 in the Euromaidan protests. That's a huge turning point. So in particular, looking at kind of that moment as a really key turning point, how would you describe the media landscape now in comparison to 8 or 9 years ago?
Great, thank you again so much. And it's an honor and pleasure to be here. The Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute does an incredible job throughout the past few decades in terms of really bringing to light Ukraine and really diving into all the issues. So thank you again so much. I'll start off a little bit with my background. So my career in journalism started in 2014. I remember back, I was an undergrad student here in the Boston area. And I remember with Oleg Kachuba, who teaches at the Institute, and then also with, I think he was a fellow at Emory College, Vitaly Moroz, we were all organizing rallies in Boston and protests against Russia, but then also in support of the Euromaidan revolution. And so I remember then graduating that year and moving to Ukraine and thinking what to do. And so I remember at the time meeting with Brian Bonner, who is the chief editor at Kyiv Post, and he quickly gave me an offer to work at the Kyiv Post as a reporter. So I was working there since 2014, and then had a number of different roles, but the one that had the most effect was when I was the business editor at the Kyiv Post. And I was managing a team, and a lot of my former colleagues are now at the Kyiv Independent. And that really gave a sense of what the media industry was back then, pre-February 24th, right? In terms of understanding what are the major trends. So I'll just kind of provide a broad stroke sort of description of how I see it and sort of what are the variables that have a huge effect in terms of the overall environment. So I would say the presence of oligarchs, obviously, that is a very huge component in terms of understanding what is going on within the media industry in Ukraine. And very few independent media outlets that were there. Kyiv Post was one of them, and we were proud and we were fighting to the very last moment in terms of having the editorial independence. And in addition to that, so within that context, obviously having access to finances on a sustainable basis, that has always been sort of a challenge, and that's not necessarily a characteristic just for Ukraine. It is within the field of journalism in general. But again, if you combine that sort of with the strong presence of oligarchs in Ukraine, that's where the challenge really does come in. Then also, I would say that training Ukrainian, journalists in general, takes time. And within the setting in Ukraine, it can be a challenge because especially if you have a high turnover, a lot of young journalists, and you know, there's always the perception of, okay, I worked for a month or two, and now I can call myself a journalist. So really is making sure that they go through proper training and keeping as high standards as possible in terms of when you have a kid. So and by the way, my boss, Brian Bonner, I think he did an incredible job in terms of establishing a strong team, and I think he has a major impact in terms of independent journalism in Ukraine that has been passed on, which is a key independent, but also in terms of there are a number of different journalists who really were under his leadership who passed on to the journal of Reuters and stuff. So now in terms of looking at what is now, I would say we have a very strong international presence right now in Ukraine in comparison to how it was prior to February 24th. Now also many Ukraine journalists are reporting for international news agencies. So either Wall Street Journal, Political, Reuters, and they are sort of the ones who had the network here established before. And so that's where they got quickly snatched up by these leading media sources. Now, I would say that the Ukrainian media, at least the English language, is more spread out in terms of its outreach internationally. And but right now, one of the big challenges is having sort of this major time constraint is really catalyzed by dealing with war. So a lot of fatigue from journalists and really strong time constraints. So that can have effect also on sort of the quality of journalism that is coming out there as well. So I can keep on, but I'm also not sure how much time we have. So I'll be happy to pass it on to my colleagues as well.
Yeah, you can always come back to, sure. To whatever point, ask the discussion to us along. So kind of
responding to the same question, mm-hmm. How the landscape changed since 2014. I would say that we hear a lot more international independent voices in Ukraine, generally speaking. Many media was established since 2014, and those media are, I think, very powerful. Some of them investigative teams, and they're looking into the corruption not only on like local level, but also looking into president of four companies, oligarchs, corruption, the corruption on the local and state levels. So I would say it's a landscape changed dramatically since 2014. And the biggest challenge, I think, to preserve those benefits that we got since 2014 and those, I think, voices to keep them around, because since the war started, since the full-scale invasion started, I think the one of the biggest challenges is to keep finance, but also to keep people, because some of them are joining the army, some of them are becoming volunteers, some of them just dropping the work because it's mentally and physically hard to keep up every day in this kind of conditions. A lot of challenges actually. And maybe later on I will talk about more of my experience.
Okay, and so my name is Taras. I'm a publisher and co-founder of the Ukrainian Media. And the Ukrainian Media is an independent, bootstrapped media company, which focusing on high quality visual and long-form journalism. And probably you, like in this place would be someone from television some TV manager, the answer could be quite different. But from my perspective, and I like would add a few points to my colleague's speeches, I think that I also totally agree that our media market is totally like quite different from the moment before the Euromaidan revolution. And it's also important to understand that like our project, it also was started just after the Euromaidan, and probably Maidan was one of the main reasons why we decided to start our company, because we wanted to change like our local media landscape, and we wanted to foster social changes in Ukraine using the tools of journalism. And at that moment, we started to publish different stories. And like I think that during this time, it's hard to say about like booms of media startups, but for sure our market became much more diverse and much more decentralized. I think that before we were like really focused on TV channels, on big mainstream legacy media, and right now like on the market you can see very different players. For sure, like small media companies with like lack of resources couldn't be very powerful in general, but it's important to have this competition and different voices on a ground. Another important point that, and also when we started the Ukrainians media, we started as Ukrainian language project, and we have a lot of questions from our colleagues like, hey guys, why do you like publish your story just in Ukrainian and not in Russian? Because at that moment, like this bilingual approach to local media was like typical, and like other media managers just don't understand our logic, because like we lose traffic, we lose like page views, and that was like different. And I think then in that today we can see quite different market conditions, and Ukrainian media market much more pro-Ukrainian and Ukrainian language speaking. And I think it's really important, because like right now we can fully understand how powerful is like Russian propaganda. And then I think maybe 5 years ago when it was a moment when like Ukrainian country bans Russian like propaganda, the TV channels, and then they banned the social networks. It was like, especially from like outside from the Ukraine, it was like a little bit strange decision. But in general, it was super crucial and important. And it's even hard to imagine what it could be right now if at that moment we didn't ban these propaganda channels. Another important point, I think that right now we have much more clear investors in Ukrainian media companies. For example, like Novoye Vremya and Ukrainska Pravda, they have like typical investor who didn't have any political story, and that's great, I think, from media market. And talking about last year, because it's also quite different, like this comparison, because in 2014 it was one context, 2022 or 2023 is quite different. And for sure, right now, almost all Ukrainian media companies are war companies, because like everyone publishing story about war, and it's for someone it could be strange, but even Ukrainian lifestyle magazine published explainers about bomb shelters, and that's like just normal right now, and that logic. Yeah, and also important point that we have this super rapid growth of social media networks, especially Telegram. It's a complicated question in general, because right now more than 60% of Ukrainian readers are like trying to get news from Telegram, because it's convenient on the one hand, but on another it's like Russian roots project, so there are a lot of challenges. And the last point, but I think my colleague talked about this, I think that 2022 is a year of Ukrainian English language journalism, because like before we had just Kyiv Post, and then we had Kyiv Independent, but right now almost all like the biggest mainstream media companies have English versions of their like projects, and it's very important.
Yes. Yeah, that's especially interesting. So I did want to obviously make, I have several questions kind of specifically about the role of journalists in the war. the idea of a lifestyle magazine talking about war. I mean, that's that illustrates exactly the point. So can you talk a little bit more about what the role of journalists has been since the full-scale invasion on February 24th of last year? Inya, you already mentioned international journalists. So is there a distinction between Ukrainian journalists and international journalists? And you know, how would you kind of assess the foreign journalist coverage of Ukraine so far? And additionally, you know, we've seen Russia targeting journalists as well. Why do you think this is part of their strategy?
Right. So I think in general, I'm always a big proponent in terms of if you can diversify the sources, the resources, as long as they're independent and they don't have any sort of propaganda structure to them, then I'm a big fan of that. So I do think that with international media, for example, they have their own pros and cons, generally speaking, and then also with Ukrainian media, you're going to have a similar structure. Now, for example, with international media, I think, you know, has the resources, has the expertise in terms of, so to speak, proper journalism. It is also, it's less biased in terms of having this international perspective that's coming in. Now, in terms of Ukrainian media, they don't necessarily always have the resources. That's a big struggle, but they do have the expertise and they understand very well in terms of what the contexts are, what are the dynamics, and sort of also they're much more in tune in terms of what are the corruption scandals and understanding sort of all the nuances. And so having a blend of both, I think, is very helpful, especially keeping international media accountable. For example, I think it was New York Times when they had the whole opinion piece about sort of Ukraine giving up Crimea and having land concessions. And, you know, that just seemed to be very sort of out of touch in terms of the reality of what's going on the ground. And so therefore, that's where the accountability comes from the Ukrainian side. Now, that's not to say that one side is better than the other, but it's just having that healthy mix, I think, is extremely helpful. And also just having sort of a wider presence, as Taras was mentioned, for example, Washington Post, they opened a Kiev bureau, I think it was back in May 2022. I think that pretty much covers on my end in terms of what the dynamics and differences are between international versus Ukrainian media. I do think one good example is sort of, I would call a hybrid, is if you look at Radio Free or Radio Liberty, I think they have a very interesting blend of, I mean, obviously they're funded by the US, but they also have some exceptional journalists who are Ukrainians and who work on the ground. They have been doing some incredible reporting at the front in the war zone. They kind of have that mix between being backed up by Western resources, but then also having that Ukraine expertise. Mm-hmm.
I think that the war for Ukrainian journalists didn't start on February 2022. It started May or March 2014. Me personally and many of my colleagues, we were covering occupation of Crimea in Crimea and Crimea when it was occupied also. And then later the war that started in Donbas. Sadly, some of the journalists, you know, I feel like many journalists in Ukraine actually feel in this frustration, you know, when especially men, when they kind of don't feel the impact of their work, and that's like pushed them into volunteering first and then joining the army. And we saw many of those unprofessional military guys who died very soon in the war. One of them, my good friend Viktor Burniak, who died in October 2014, So to the point that journalists are important, they're doing their job, but also seeing how their colleagues are dying regularly and risking their life every day, it's kind of emotionally draining and frustrating. So right now, many programs or many organizations which are supporting Ukrainian journalists, they're investing money into the mental health programs. As I know, many journalists experiencing burnout and they're quitting their jobs, but also others who are staying, incredibly courageous people who are definitely risking their life many more or many more often since the full-scale invasion. As we know, I think 67 journalists has been killed since the beginning of full-scale invasion, and one of them is an Indian fellow, Brent Renault, and also my other dear friend, Max Levin, the incredible photographer, and you can read the piece about him in The New Yorker, I think it was published last week. The role of journalists in Ukraine cannot be underestimated, and it's emotionally, I think, hard to be to report this kind of stories every day, but also live in the story and take care of family and loved ones at the same time. So a lot of challenges for journalism and journalists, but also I kind of admire this courage and bravery of Ukrainian journalists. And it's incredibly, me myself, I think one of the most powerful moments, I think, to meet other journalists somewhere in the field in Donbas, you know, and to talk about like, oh, I've been in Lysychansk and I've been in Severodonetsk, you know, have this kind of a chit chat. The other thing, I think it's not that hard to report maybe from the trenches to be embedded with soldiers, but to talk to the mothers of killed people or killed children and talk to the wounded kids in the hospitals. This is like emotionally really exhausting. It's not only physically hard, but also emotionally.
If someone could just build and kind of smash it, then that it's I'm not a journalist in general, I'm a media manager. Sounds like more like this. And I think that it's important to understand that we have this huge struggle between professional and personal. Because for example, if you're talking about, I don't know, New York Times Bureau or like Bureau of Foreign Media, they have the top of rotation. So like someone come to Ukraine to, you know, 2 weeks, do their job and come back. Mm-hmm. You're writing stories about like people in general. On one hand, on another hand, you have 8 years in like of living in this context, and you're writing stories about like your friends, your colleagues, and it's super hard. So it's a huge challenge in general. Another story that for sure, like after the start of a full-scale war, especially like during last year, it's much more complicated to do the job. And for sure, Russia, like a part of the influence is that like Russian soldiers are like killing Ukrainians on the front line, like journalists who are joining the military or journalists who are doing their job. But another story that they're just trying to make our like workflows as hard as possible, so destroying all our like thermal stations, like electricity plants. The story about the making our like real like typical life much harder. Mm-hmm. So we can, for sure, we can say about like our brave colleagues, they're doing their job with a candlelight, like by candlelight, with the SpaceX internet stations and Starlink stations and generators. Or it's much more harder to work right now because like the teams are displaced, so all over the world, and someone, for sure, we understand that after the start of the pandemic, it's much harder to cooperate online. But at that moment, it's really complicated. Another challenge for media companies is that your colleague could be drafted. And for example, like just imagine the story. If it's especially it's like about all the companies, but especially about independent media companies which have not so many people in a company. If you have a department, for example, podcast department, and you have three people in general, if you lose one person from this team, you lose 33% of your efficiency. And sometimes small media companies just like disappear because of that moment. And the last point about cyber attacks, for sure, like Russian hackers also trying to influence on the territory. And during the last year, the Russian carried out more than 40 DOS attacks for like Ukrainian media. And that's the last point. It's about this content, emotional exhaustion, because it's really just like mentally complicated, hard to do all this, to be all the time in such conditions.
Mm-hmm. Tanya, you mentioned the kind of need for mental health support and that sort of thing. So can any of you talk a little bit about the programs, either state-run or otherwise, that are designed to support journalists? Obviously, in the past year, there's been more attention on this, but you've all highlighted that journalists have been covering the war already since 2014. So it's not as if these are brand new concerns, right? It's just that the landscape is different and perhaps there's more people are affected. So I'm curious, what types of help do people need? What types of help is available to them? And any additional challenges that you want to point out that journalists have been facing that are new since 2022 that you think that they didn't face before, even though obviously the war has been going on since 2014.
Sure, yeah. So I'll just tell a story. When I was in Ukraine this past winter, I remember speaking with a journalist and the experience that they went through. I mean, it was two journalists, and they were at the war zone, and they were together, kind of being accompanied by some Ukrainians to pick up the dead bodies of Ukrainian soldiers. And while the Ukrainians were picking up those bodies, they exploded because the bodies were mined. And so that was in front of the journalists. So that's just, that's an example in terms of that can happen every day, any day. And so that's what you're dealing with. And so that obviously is having a huge mental toll in terms of what you're going through. There are specialized mental health professionals that specifically work with journalists who are affected by the war. And so I think that needs to be strengthened. And so there's also, people who are more connected, say, journalists who are more connected, if they're working for an established news organization, then they will know about those resources and it will be affordable for them. Now, if we're talking about sort of journalists who are, Ukrainian journalists who are working for either less known, but, more local media sources, it's going to be, it's either unaffordable or they just don't even know about those resources, right? And so that is a major need over there, and it will show itself that need in the next few years as well. This is not a short-term sort of solution. The other thing is fatigue. Fatigue is huge. I mean, fatigue was huge. I remember back at Kyiv Post, we're, you know, working until like 1 a.m. trying to hit the deadline. But I mean, that, you know, you take that and then you multiply that, you know, multifold, that's sort of the fatigue that you're dealing with. And so I can't even imagine in terms of what journalists are dealing with right now. That has a huge toll. Again, it has a toll on your mental, on your physical health, and you're exhausted. You can't afford, as Taras was saying, you can't afford like New York Times where you have a transition, someone comes up and picks up your spot, then you can sort of, you know, take some rest. So those are the kind of nuances that, and you know, you could go on talking about this for hours, but those are the kind of nuances that journalists are dealing with. And especially if you're a Ukrainian journalist, the likelihood of those difficulties, you're going to be dealing with that to a much larger scale. I'd also say that it's important to have the proper training, especially how to behave in a war zone. I mean, you know, you'll have young journalists who are going out there, and if they don't have the proper training, I mean, their life is even more endangered than it would be even if you do have the training. So I think other things is training in terms of what can you report on, what can you not report on. I think it's important to, you know, especially if you don't have much experience in journalism, and if you want to get a story out, or if you want to get the information out, and you think that this is going to be either good for the public, or perhaps it's going to, you know, get you more popularity. This was visible, especially during the first 2 months during the full-scale invasion. It's, you know, you just had all this sensitive information that was coming out there, and so that also requires training as well. But you know, this is not necessarily just specific for the post February 24th environment in media in Ukraine, but I would say that there tends to be a lack of management expertise, because you know, when you're dealing with the media agency, it's not just about the journalists, but it's also about the proper understanding of how to manage the business, and how do you make sure that your journalists are actually staying sane within the tense environment. And so oftentimes you won't have proper human resource department where it could kind of be mitigating and helping journalists with the difficulties that they're going through. And two very quick last points. One is educating personnel takes a long time. So again, this is something like, it is an investment for making sure that you have a properly trained journalist. And it is going to be so much more sensitive if it comes to sending them to the war zone. That was a problem, I would say, pre-February 24th, but I can only imagine that it is going to be even much worse now. I also think that a lot of the Ukrainian media that reports in Ukrainian is not getting enough attention. I mean, we hear from sort of the English language Ukrainian media, but I think that there are some exceptional journalists out there who are reporting in Ukrainian. And I think that information needs to be picked up. You know, it's sometimes just a matter of translating and, you know, adding captions or whatever, but there is some very helpful information out there, but it's just not getting out there to us, to the international audience, just because they don't have the proper resources. So I will, I do think in terms of how to help journalists, specifically Ukrainian journalists, there are different scholarships that can be established. Also, I know the Center for European Policy Analysis, as an example, they're providing fellowships to a number of Ukrainian journalists on a yearly basis. And so those are just sort of, that's an example of how you can be supporting Ukrainian journalists as well, with the training, keeping their sanity, and providing them opportunities here financially, et cetera. So I'll stop there.
If I can talk about myself, It happened to be that I was in Ukraine when the war started, and it was probably not a big news for me because I was kind of covering the news or following the news about imminent invasion. And since the beginning of the year, I think like I was not like celebrating Christmas and New Year with my like friends and family. Instead of this, we were like traveling around the country and watching how the country was preparing to the war. And it happened to be that nothing was prepared and people were not expecting it happens. And especially people near the border, they were just not knowing what is coming, and they were refusing to believe. And like, you know, when 10 journalists showed up in one village and started asking those questions, they were super annoyed, those people, right? So, but to the point when the war started, like we were mentally prepared, those journalists who were covering the imminent invasion, I think we were able to go and work from like starting 4 a.m. The big problem for me personally was that we didn't know when it will finish. So I was working for 5 months with no weekends covering like wounded, killed, raped, and in this situation where all Ukrainian journalists and none of them were able to get a vacation or go and rest and have weekends. And in some media, some Ukrainian media, as I know, some chief editors were saying, we don't have any weekends or breaks until the war will end. And the sad story is that it's still lasting. Yeah, you can imagine the fatigue that journalists, Ukrainian journalists are going through. And the other aspect, I think, is martial law. So some women can leave the country and take a break and actually take a rest. But men, they cannot go anywhere. They're kind of stuck in the country, and they're obligated to be in the country. It's also influence, of course, like people who are going through traumatic experience or always exposed to trauma or witnessing the other people who went through trauma, their own like creativity is lacking, right? So it's a big challenge, I think, also for Ukrainian journalists, especially those who are both men and women. Saying that it's easier for women, for sure not. The other thing that I wanted to highlight that one of the things that Taras mentioned, the popularity of Telegram, that is like stealing the attention from Ukrainian media and Ukrainian journalists. Sadly speaking, it's getting more popularity, but at the same time, it's spreading more fakes. And sometimes it's like very, so what Ukrainian journalists, they are slower, right, than the Telegram channels, but also they kind of are trying to verify all the information. But the readership is like, sadly, the numbers are getting lower and lower every day. The other thing, the safety part, I think, to your point about the trainings, so I think many journalists in Kyiv who covered the war in Donbas, they were prepared, they had these trainings. But most of the local journalists in the other part of the country, they were not prepared at all for the full-scale invasion. They didn't have any trainings, they didn't have flat jackets, they didn't have helmets. So it was kind of a big mess in the beginning. Now it's kind of a better situation, much better. I think flat jackets and helmets are not, like PPE is not an issue anymore. The situation with trainings are also getting better. I think many organizations are providing specific trainings for the journalism. To the mental health issue, I think that some organizations are actually providing those kind of assistance and help but yeah, to it's just, I think, a lot of stories and a lot of a big intensity of the work. I think this is, you know, exhausting.
Well, talking about challenges, I think we can do like separate events and or series of events, and want to talk about like everything, because it's really we have a lot of problems right now. But I will go to the from the micro to macro level, and I think that like from media manager perspective, the one of the most important stories right now, it's one of in the most important challenges is a financial challenge. And I just found the information that according to the Ukrainian Institute for Mass Information data, more than 200 regional news media outlets went bankrupt or were forced to shut down because of the invasion. And on the one hand, it's issue, it's a question of money. On another hand, it's impossible to do your job in an occupied, temporary occupied city. It's like logical. And like when we started our project almost 9 years ago, one of the things that we like really didn't like that the most popular business model in our media market was advertising and oligarch business model, as we if we could say it like this. So on the one hand, like media companies make their money with the ads, so they work with traffic to like clickbait content, clickbait stories, which bring more page views, and we can do much like more money with the banner ads. And another story when some like very rich politician invest in a media company and use it as a weapon for a political like for struggle. And but right now even these two business models are like breaking down. And for example, talking about the advertising market. During the last year, advertising market in Ukraine was almost dead, and right now it's like slowly recovering from that. And according to the Ukrainian Advertisement Coalition data, last year we saw a decline in advertisement revenue in television by 81%. In print and 61%, and in radio 79%. So like that's huge, and that's super obvious that during when the war is going on, it's like no one invests in advertising. But that's a like really big challenge, because for example, if right now we can see that like the biggest media companies can like work again with this like companies and to promote something. If we are talking about local publishers who get money from like local advertisers, from local businesses, which have like same economical struggles. So that's a huge challenge, and just newsroom just closing down and finishing their work. Now the other story, and it's like part of ideal story, that it would be great if readers will support the media companies, but right now it's super hard for sure, because the like total economical situation is becoming worse and worse, and all the money that like people have, they're trying to invest in like to donate to humanitarian and army needs. In our case at the finance media, we have something like fantastically different, and during the last year we grow our membership program in more than like two times, and that's a really like special story. But in general, if you're talking about reader support, it's really hard. So the last point is that donor funding is the most important right now, and I think that the mainstream like leading media companies, they survived just because of donor funding from international and European foundations. So that's about the voice of our business.
Yeah, I would just like to add to the point in terms of financing. So I think it's safe to say that sort of media prospers
and unfortunately, you know, media prospers the most during crises, right? So in terms of, like, you can see the same thing that happened during the Euromaidan revolution. I think, you know, at least locally based media, right? In terms of, because that's where the attention is coming from. I remember Kiev Post, that's when we had the most views, right? And you can just sort of multiply that in terms of with how big the crisis is with Russia's war against Ukraine, how that sort of just multiplies that effect. Now, what I'm also leading to is that it's not sustainable, right? So it's like what we're seeing right now is not going to be what will necessarily be in 5 years and in 10 years in terms of what's going to be going on within Ukrainian media. So it is very important and needs to be creative in terms of thinking like, okay, well, how can we establish a more sustainable structure of financing where you're not always dependent in terms of, you know, advertisements, for example. I remember that was a huge issue, always discussion that we had, you know, at Kiev Post in terms of like, A, everyone is sort of tapping in for the same advertisers because you don't have a very big business sector relevant, say, compared to places like the US. And so you'll see oftentimes same advertisers like in Ukrainska Pravda, Kiev Post, and elsewhere. And so that's one issue. Then you're also dealing with, you're trying to go for applying for grants. That takes a lot of time. And so that is definitely a major factor in terms of just the media sector. And then looking at right now, I think Taras, you mentioned it, or you know, in terms of a lot of journalists, especially during the first few months, they were living off of their savings, they were volunteering their time. That was their, how they were, you know, they were basically using whatever they could in terms of to do the reporting. And if they weren't getting the financial resources, then they either quit or, you know, they're just dealing even with a bigger bigger constraint. And so, but just as a side note, if, you know, if there are people considering in terms of like donating or like providing financial help to journalists, my suggestion is keep in mind, especially those media sources that are not as well known and that are perhaps more on the periphery, look into it and try to understand in terms of like, are they independent? Are they doing a good job? And really try to sort of diversify the journalists who are receiving the support from the West. So. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. I think that's really interesting. It's interesting, especially because we saw this proliferation of coverage during the Euromaidan, you know, of journalists who kind of figured out new ways to represent the stories that were happening. And I think that's something that has been, the interest in that has been sustained, I think we can say, and has created this situation or context where we do have, you know, a media sphere that is capable of covering this war and this invasion to the rest of the world. And that's really, you know, something that has made, I think it's been really helpful in representing Ukraine to the world, right? The context already exists. But I want to talk about the kind of information front of the war. Obviously, we talk a lot, and you all have brought up already Telegram and information and misinformation, disinformation. This is something that, you know, the Russian Federation has been doing really intentionally for, I don't know, let's say 20 years, and that's a generous, you know, small assessment. But obviously, right, that's part of the front of this war. So what do you think that Ukraine is doing right in the fight against misinformation and disinformation? What do you maybe think that Ukraine or Ukrainian journalists aren't doing right or could do more for? And, you know, how do you sort of see the future of this going? You've all mentioned Telegram. That's something that I have to say, I mean, I never used Telegram before, and I'm shocked to learn when American journalists who talk to me about Ukraine don't know what Telegram is. Like, it's also new for Americans. We don't know anything about Telegram. So lucky. I mean, we've talked about the shifting media landscape, but that's part of it. And we've talked about the sort of the difference in foreign coverage and what Ukrainians know that they're covering, right? So anyway, that's a very broad question about information and misinformation. Yeah.
Well, I would say there is no other way to battle the misinformation than just to tell the truth. And sadly speaking, like for myself, the biggest discovery here at Harvard was to find out that people are susceptible to Putin's propaganda, even in the like very well-educated society like Harvard, you know? So it's not about how educated you are or not, it's about you are being not lazy to double check the source of information that you're getting, or to get the something from media, from the actual witnesses of the events, not just scroll Twitter and think that everything that is published in Twitter is true. So I think this is about that, and there is no other way, I think, just tell people to it. And I think Russian misinformation was and is, I think, super dangerous. And I think people in US also experienced it during the presidential election in 2016, but also on January 6th, right? So there was a lot of, I think, events in US which can be kind of a scene like the examples of big disinformation campaigns that Ukrainian people is going through right now. Yeah, and it's very challenging because even, you know, on the occupied territories or the territories that are near the occupied territories, there are like mostly the only accessible media is like radio, and it's like radio that broadcasting like Russian propaganda, and they're saying like something like President of Ukraine left the country, you're by yourself here alone, you know. So they're like spreading complete disinformation in people who are on the occupied territory and who don't have even like a cell phone connection or internet, and they cannot verify this information. They kind of you know, very much this is the only source of information, the radio, that they like lend radio. So it's the situation is terrible right now, and the main truthful way of getting information is internet, but like given the facts that like the constant blackouts and lack of internet, I mean right now during I think last 2 weeks, the situation is a bit better. But before that, that was a challenge to get any information. And it's very, I think, dangerous situation.
I can just add to this, to Dan's point. I think that like when we are talking about the war, it's hard to talk about like some positive consequences in general. But for example, Ukrainian military, like people from the military, they always talking that like right now at 2022, our Ukrainian army was much more powerful and prepared than at 2015. And I think the same story with the media literacy in the country in general, because during the last 8 years, we had like, I saw a lot of like different campaigns from like schools to like seniors. And that's super important. And if we're talking about the banning of the Russian social media, in total, it could be like super influential. And I think that's like very important. And in general, if you are talking about like unoccupied part, like part of Ukraine, for sure, people understood that Russian propaganda in general failed. Total different situation on temporary occupied part of our country. But Right now we have another challenge, it's like special informational operations, which like Ukraine, Russian propaganda and hackers do. So we, and for example, Telegram or Viber is also is an instrument for these operations when like someone, like brother of my father or like some person like told me that in 2 days, like Belarus will start invasion. And this story when like people trying to connect with like with family and relatives and they don't check the critical perspective, it's like super popular, unfortunately, and we can see this all the time. And they're trying just like Russian just trying to make this like average temperature or in, like in a country higher than it should be.
So, I think, you know, I first want to start off with a more with a positive note in terms of what the accomplishments that have been done by journalists, both Ukrainian and international. So we've been dealing with this since 2014, at least, right? In terms of Russia's war against Ukraine. So this is so the tactics in terms that Russia has been applying have been similar in terms of trying to do disinformation, misinformation. And so a lot of journalists know what to expect. And so therefore, once February 24th was coming, I would say that actually, because of all the work that has been done by journalists, they had a much, they were more prepared in terms of how to respond on the international media stage. Now, I think because Ukraine was able to sort of get ahead of Russia in terms of winning over that information space within those first weeks, there was an incredible and significant advantage for Ukraine nowadays in terms of understanding what really is happening. I also think that, you know, this is partially thanks to Ukrainian media, partially thanks to the Ukrainian public in general with a strong resistance and really just wanting to show what's going on. And also partially, I would say this is not mentioned frequently, but I do think that the US intelligence community played a significant role in making sure that Russia was not sort of acting in this sort of shocking approach in terms of being unexpected, right? So that really did serve Ukraine well in terms of winning over the information space. Then also the US intelligence then, I mean, that worked well for them as well. So in terms of the propaganda, I think it's important to understand A, that Ukraine is being targeted, then also Russia is being targeted, and then different parts of Ukraine are targeted in different ways. I don't remember who did the research, but it was showing that, you know, there's significant difference between Eastern and Southern Ukraine in terms of who's being, in terms of Russian propaganda targeting compared to other parts of Ukraine. And I think that's important to understand as well, that some parts of Ukraine's population have been, I like to view as in terms of victims of Russian propaganda for a much longer period of time and more concentrated, say, than compared to other parts of Ukraine. I also think it's important to understand that the propaganda machine in Russia is working against its own people as well. And as much as, you know, perhaps it's, you know, it's easy to shove off that whole discussion, I think it is important to understand, is there even some kind of solution in terms of dealing with this? And how long will it take? Because this has been going on in a very concentrated way for decades in terms of Russia targeting its own people, because the informational differences are night and day in terms of what people hear in Ukraine and what people hear in Russia. I think that is going to be a significant part of Ukraine's victory, because I mean, arguably that's what started this war in the first place in terms of with the propaganda machine that was focused on Russians and on Ukrainians. Mm-hmm.
Before we turn to audience question, anybody want to add any final thoughts, anything you didn't get to say so far? Ready for audience questions? Well, we have plenty of time, so anybody want to move?
Yeah, Taras mentioned about this conflict between personal and professional sometimes. And so how do you and other journalists manage this conflict? So one of the examples, for example, when a journalist discloses information about corruption in some ministry agency, that may, in the short term, potentially harm national security to a certain extent. But at the same time, in the long term, it may help national security by cleaning this agency out of corruption. So how this decision making is going, how you are settling this conflict between being objective or sometimes, you know, abstaining from giving truth?
I think I will start and then we'll pass to my colleagues. First of all, when I talk about the struggle, I mean that this conflict, but the situation when you are on the front line and you're seeing how your people are dying. That's typical journalists from come from Germany, for them, it's just a person. For sure, you have human being inside, but you are a professional also, and you doing your job. In our case, it's much more harder. If we are talking about the corruption scandals, I think the kind of told it already, the truth is the answer. And in general, for sure, if journalists solve corruption scandals, we should, I understand what you mean, that if we, for example, this case with Ukrainian Ministry of Defense, that something was true. So there was some troubles
there is another information about the losses of Ukrainian armies. There are different kinds of information that we may decide not to disclose.
But corruption and losses, it's also different stories because we have law on one hand and we have something more on another. And for example, I remember the story when during the first weeks of full-scale invasion, when I think that was journalists from CNN who the international journalists, they just saw the newest footage, how for example, missiles come to and destroy Ukrainian villages, and they just publish it. But for Russian forces, it's almost obvious to understand the trajectory of this, how it goes, and to use it against Ukrainians one more time. So it's one story, and the story about losses, you don't have any official information, so it's hard to manipulate with this story. But if you are talking about corruption, that's logical. You should.
Very few stories recently published by, or should I say reported by Ukrainian journalists about corruption, and they were very they had really good timing, and I think they were very important to the point where Zelensky and his government had immediate reaction. So I think it's important to tell those stories about corruption in Ukraine during the war in Ukraine, just because the reaction, because from my own experience, when I was before the war, I was working as a investigative journalist, we had impact very rarely. It was almost never, and we were keep doing it just because we feel better about it ourselves, so we were trying to do something, but we almost never had impact. Now, there is a reaction to every story, which is about corruption. And I think it's a good thing and very important that government is very reactive to the story and not trying to put pressure on the journalist or not trying to implement the censorship on like specifically independent media who are publishing these stories, right? So it's a good thing. And I think, it's great that it's happening actually.
So I also just wanted to add in terms of, so I think this is also where it comes to the Russian propaganda question. And I'm going to be very careful in terms of, when we're discussing about reporting on corruption in Ukraine, because that can get easily picked up by the Kremlin in terms of to create division, right? And so, but at the same time, I think this is what makes Ukraine very different from Russia, is that it can afford to have investigative journalism there. I do think that we're seeing a decrease for now of investigative journalism. Either it's because of just there are other priorities, but B, it's also, I mean, investigative journalism, Danny can affirm this, it's very resource intensive, right? It's not, you can't just like write it within a day or two. It takes you, it's time intensive. And also like if you need to travel, if you need to be, using particular equipment, that all takes financing. So, and then in terms of also, how do you then publish the story? Do you publish in one piece? Do you publish in five different pieces? And that's where it comes to what I was talking about in terms of the effect of an outreach that you're trying to have. So, but I do think that it is important that Ukraine continues with investigative pieces. I think Brookings Institution had a great piece in talking about how investigative journalism is going to be very important for the reconstruction of Ukraine, because there's going to be a lot of quick business deals, and there's a ton of inflow of money that's going to be happening, and you need to have transparency with that. You need to have accountability. And also with a more centralized government, which makes complete sense when it's during war, but it also requires accountability, because in a democracy, I mean, that's where investigative journalism has a very important role within that democratic fabric, right? In terms of holding those in power accountable. So I hope that we will be seeing to some degree more investigative pieces, but I also hope that that is tangential with the more, with a wiser response now coming from the Ukrainian community, as well as understanding that, hey, you know, if there is corruption scandal in the Ukraine government, this doesn't characterize all of Ukraine's government. I think, you know, that is going to be very different than what you have seen like a decade ago. Is like, well, there's investigative piece, well, therefore the whole government is corrupt. So I think that people understand that there are more nuances, and that if there is a particular corruption piece, and you know, we need to kind of investigate it further. And if the person that is being reported about is indeed corrupt, then you know, they must be removed. That's where the Zelensky administration can play a very important role in using this momentum and making sure that one investigative piece is published and those corrupt scandals are exposed. That's when he removes them completely. But one just last note is that removing individuals is important, but what's even more important is so that keep the Ukrainian government accountable so that there is structural reform. And specifically when it comes to the judicial aspect of accountability, some judicial reform, and that's where you will be able to take care of many other problems. So I'm bringing that up because I remember many times when we were reporting at Kiev Post, you'll notice how there's going to be either someone removed once or twice, and then it's more of a cosmetic touch, right? You're not taking care of the structural problem.
Thanks so much, everyone, for putting us together. It's amazing. Thank you for our best speakers. I'm Yulia Lemesh from Ukraine. I'm a CNB student at HPS. I wanted to come back to the question of language. So I wonder, so I understand kind of trying to the Ukrainians, so that's the idea from the very beginning to like in Ukraine and in English, right? For Kiev was like no question asked, it was English from the very beginning. But I wonder, you know, what is like the best standard right now after the war? And are there like journalists, some journalists switching from Russian to Ukrainian or maybe vice versa, just trying to reach out to like the, you know, all communities speaking different languages within Ukraine or even introducing English? Because like from my own observation, right, like Ukraine's propaganda is still like in three languages, Ukrainian, Russian, English. Mm-hmm. When you look at actually on the weekend I watched that new documentary by Dmytro Komarov. When he spoke to a president, he would speak in Ukrainian, but then, you know, in colloquial language he would use Russian and Ukrainian in that movie. And also yesterday I also watched The House Made of Splinters. Obviously that's nominated Oscar, it's in Russian, but because it, of course, it's about orphanage in the eastern part of Ukraine, Lysychansk, it all makes sense to us as Ukrainians. But I wonder if there's like best standard at all, you know, within the journalism in Ukraine, or like which language to choose to use. Just your thoughts about it.
Well, I'm happy to end it. Sorry. So I think the language conversation is a very sensitive conversation that, especially right now, it has been, at least since 2014. And I, you know, obviously with the magnitude of the scale of what's going on within the country, it is that much more sensitive. I remember, being in Ukraine the last time, and then also during the summer, is a lot of Russian speaking Ukrainians are switching to Ukrainian. That's their way of showing patriotism and support. But there are also a lot of people, especially from the most vulnerable parts of the country, that are heavily Russian speaking. And I think that, it will depend on, A, is it a regional, local newspaper? And where are they located? Are they more in the south and in the east? But then also, I think it's important what Ukrainska Pravda is doing. I think they're doing it completely, they're correct that they're having three languages, because if they're only, preaching to the choir that, who already agree with them, then that's good. But you also need to be doing outreach to people who they could likely affect either in Ukraine, although it's going to be a much smaller percentage than it used to be in terms of those who are pro-Russian, it's going to be minuscule. And also reaching people who are in Russia as well.
I think that in your question there are a few different levels before, and first of all, it's important to distinguish like personal level of communication and like public level. And for example, I have a lot of friends who speak in Russian, like in real life, but if they have like something in public, they speak Ukrainian, because right now it's not about culture, it's about political position, and that's about defense strategy. Because like I read a piece by Yaroslav Hatsak, like famous Ukrainian historian, and he wrote like interesting thought that one of our challenges, like in because of Russian-speaking Ukrainians, it was that for them the Russian language was the bigger language which helped them to connect to the global society, not English but Russian. And because of that, we have much more this basically propaganda-based challenges right now. And I think you also know about the law that all the Ukrainian media right now, that they should have Ukrainian version of their website. Talking about Ukrainska Pravda, as far as I understand, they have 40% of their visitors read Russian part of website. And a huge part of this percent is people from abroad, from Russia also. But I'm sure that it just we are in the middle of this process, and in the future we will have mostly two versions, Ukrainian and English.
I would say that it's a technical question, because for sure, most of Ukrainian media is easy for them to publish immediately the news in Ukrainian. It's faster for them to translate in Russian. And it's very slower, or it's generally slower to translate into English. So, and in terms of, like, for example, a lot of foreigners in Ukraine or abroad can read Russian mostly, not Ukrainian version. So in terms of the access to the information, I think it's good to have Russian version because it's more updated and it's more like close to the date, you know. The English version, I think, always like kind of a, you know, it's a bit slower. Even though like Ukrainska Pravda, as many other Ukrainian media has it, it doesn't mean it's very good, you know, or it's like, I think it's technical more issue, to be honest. And I think it's good to have Russian version because again, to the Ilya point, we are like picking up Russian audience too, which is, I think, very important to inform this part of the world so they know what is happening in Ukraine. The other issue, I think most of the web pages, they're blocked. So Russians has to download VPN, connect to the VPN and go find Ukrainska Pravda, you know? So it's like, but the information is there, it's, you know, they have the access to it. So I think it's not bad.
And one quick note that about money in general, because it's like also a huge issue in this context, because I understand the challenge of media manager that when you, for example, you are thinking, should I close 40% of my, like, to destroy 40% of my traffic or and lose 40% of my money from the banner ads or not. So I'm sure that they are just trying to rebuild it because like if someone from Russia saw a banner ad of Ukrainska Pravda and someone from the US, media company will have much more money from US viewer for sure. So it's like, we're just doing this process of changing this.
Yeah, thank you so much for sharing your personal experiences. I have huge respect for your work and what you've experienced. As there are several journalists in this room, including myself, I was wondering what can we learn from you, Ukrainian journalists who have already lived there and reported on these issues, either reporting on the Ukraine war from the outside. I've personally reported on the Ukraine, but not from Ukraine, from Germany. But also for people who might go to Ukraine in the future and report from that, even though you're getting training and you're getting prepared, everything, but still you're Ukrainian and you've already lived that experience for so many years. So maybe you could also learn from you.
Well, I would say that the biggest mistake that many international media or foreign journalists are doing in Ukraine is like parachuting without any knowledge about the country, the context, the language. Sometimes they don't know the language, very often, I would say. And just kind of, and often they have the drafted story in their head, you know, that they just need names and quotes. And they kind of don't care what is the reality. They just have the idea and they want to kind of execute it. So this is, I think, the biggest, you know, like my advice would be to kind of have contact with Ukrainian journalists so they will inform you. Or kind of a follow the Ukrainian media before going there to just know the context, the reality. To have a good Ukrainian producer, which I think there are many right now. So it's, it's also hard to tell because, you know, not many Ukrainian journalists know English. So many fixers during the war were people who are like artists and like photographers, you know, they were doing this job, but they're not journalists. They don't know the context again. So it was a bit of a mess at the beginning, but I think now you can find a decent producer, fixer, how would you call it? And just trust, like to have trust to Ukrainian journalists, I think it's a good thing. Because, again, as I said, that there are some constraints, I think, that foreigners have towards the problem, their own vision, they're coming with their own agenda, which sometimes can be harmful, I think.
I would also add to that is in terms of, on one hand, have a wide palette of journalists that you follow and understand that they're all, you know, everyone has their own angle in terms of what they're reporting and how they're reporting. And, you know, are there journalists who are reporting from Kyiv or are there journalists who are reporting from the trenches? Those are going to be very different perspectives as well in terms of what you're, the kind of information that you're getting. And in addition to that, as Tanya was saying, is whenever, for those who are within the profession, if you're reporting on Ukraine, do it with a very critical eye in terms of making sure that you're not being susceptible to Russian propaganda. Because it was very obvious in 2014, I remember I wrote an opinion piece about this in Kyiv Post, about how, remember there's three, I think it was Washington Post, NPR, and I forget who's the third one, but it was sort of looking at sort of the election map in Ukraine a few years ago and saying like, hey, well, look, you know, because you have this part of the western part of Ukraine that's supporting this candidate and the eastern part of Ukraine that's supporting this candidate, therefore, well, you know, it's a divided country. And that was completely giving in to the Russian propaganda about trying to instigate a civil war within Ukraine. And so if you understand what's going on within the country, that will make you much less susceptible to that kind of propaganda that is very, very sort of deep set within both reporting and then also within the academia, within the West, when it comes to the region. I think that's just also a good sort of lesson for when reporting on in other regions across the globe, and making sure that you don't jump to conclusions and assumptions. And just because it's being, say, reported by the New York Times, you know, it means that we don't have to sort of double check and or triple check in terms of what's going on.
Yeah, I just want to quickly add, many foreign journalists who are in Ukraine right now, they used to be a Moscow correspondent, and they have all this context they're bringing to Ukraine, which is also kind of a distortion, I would say. So it's not like that they know what they're talking about, or they know people, or they have contacts. It doesn't mean anything, you know. They were just Moscow correspondents, and they all sometimes think that they know Ukraine, or they know anything about Ukraine, but in reality they don't. So,
which frankly is its own commentary on how the world sees Ukraine, and academia, I will say, is guilty of positioning Ukraine in a similar way as well. So I think we have time for one more question.
Okay. I'm a Fulbright journalist staying at the USJP program at Harvard, and I was non-resident Moscow correspondent who covered Ukraine from 2014 until 2018. And I was really interested in what you pointed out, especially many colleagues are actually from Moscow, former Moscow correspondent. So they were so much biased. But then I was stationing at the Geneva in Switzerland. So I could have much more better experience in Ukraine. So what I would like to know from you is what's the situation with how you guys make living with as a working as a journalist in Ukraine. You mentioned about the funding from the foreign organizations or donations or foreign fundraising, whatever. But the, after the war, I'm pretty sure not so number of donors will decline. And also last year I was in Tokyo and I was watching the news. Telegram was pretty fast. And many important people, including government officials, just released the latest information through the Telegram. So we news organizations are we are facing very tough time because the officials can provide the information very quickly. So what would be the role for we journalists, especially news agencies? So my question is, I would like to know one thing. It's how do you journalist colleagues in Ukraine make a living? And the second is, after the war especially, donation will be less and less. So what future do you expect?
I'm lucky because I can afford myself to work for foreign media, and this is what I do since 2016. And I very rarely engage with Ukrainian media just because I can work for foreign media. And there is like a big demand right now. So it was never a problem for me to kind of find a job or I'm choosing for who I will work, you know? So it's kind of for journalists who know English and who are well connected and who have sources and everything, it's a golden era, you know, in Ukraine. For majority of journalists, it's a tough time to live through. As I say at the beginning, most some of them quitting their jobs, some of them, doing something else just because there is no salary, there is no money in the company, especially if we're talking about local journalists, local small media. In the long term, I think it will be tough and big challenge, and I think Ukrainian journalism will go through its worst time. But I think it's important to keep people, you know. If people will be around, I think we'll go through it.
So I think I agree, and I also think that I was in a very privileged position being at Kyiv Post, working for English language newspaper, because if you're working for English language newspaper, even if it is Ukrainian, and despite all the difficulties that it comes with, and especially in terms with editorial independence and making sure that you protect it, that's still, because you do have that connection, because you're being read by, you know, different ambassadors, political figures, different CEOs, it's very different setting than for the majority of Ukrainian journalists who are out there. And so that's why I was saying, as just an example, you need to be creative in terms of how you can be supporting, especially Ukrainian language media out there, in terms of making sure that those journalists aren't missing out as well. That's where maybe the translation part comes in. I think there's also, says had nothing to do with Ukraine, but I remember there are sort of creative ways of thinking of how to support journalists in general. There are some ideas about creating a platform, for example, where any journalist can have their own sort of profile, then based on sort of the topic that they're writing about, and if they have enough interest from people, you can donate to them, contribute directly, kind of thing. So that's pros and cons, but it needs to be a creative process. And just as Tanya mentioned as well, sort of the dynamics between American English language media and Ukrainian language media are going to be quite different.
Thank you for your question, because I think it's, as a media manager, it's really important, because all the time when we talking about journalism in general, and when we don't talk about business models, it's it shouldn't be like this. And because for sure journalism is important, but infrastructure of this journalism stories is much more important. So we should have money just to do our work. Talking about the business models, I think it's like the main question is the moment that when we will win. So if it will be like this year, it's like one story. If not, it's another story. But in general, I'm sure that if we have like toughest time during this year or next year, I think that foundation money, like donors funding, will be the most important and the biggest part of this budget. If we will win in a few months or at least this year, I think like advertisement part of a market and also a reader's revenue part will be growing. And the most and the last point and really relevant to this that if you are talking about reader support for Ukrainians, like $5 here and $5 in a country with different currencies and like different rates, it's different amount of value. So it's really important. So the role of Ukrainian diaspora and also the role of people who care about democracy, first of all, become much bigger. So I'm just like asking you to support Ukrainian independent media companies, and because it's important and it could be your part of Ukrainian rebuilding.
Perfect way to conclude this wonderful discussion. Thank you so much to our three panelists for pairing with us. Thank you so much for sharing so much personal information, stories from your experiences, but also for this kind of forward-looking conclusion. I think it's really appreciated. So two final things, two upcoming events I'd like to invite everybody to. On Monday, March 6th, from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., the Ukrainian Research Institute is co-sponsoring a screening of and discussion of the film Wounded Land that's organized by the Data Center for Russian and Eurasian Studies. That's in the Psy Auditorium, which is in the CBIS South building in the basement. And then on Wednesday, a week from today, in this room, we are having an event, Babinyar, Ukrainian Poets Respond. That is a book that our publications program has published and will be joined by the two translators, Ostap Keen and John Hennessy. It'll be moderated by manager of publications, Oleg Kotuba. So I hope to see you all there. Thank you everyone for coming. Thanks for working with me.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.